All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. I'm again delighted today to have with us Nitin Kashyap ji, and today he is going to enlighten all of us with the topic degrees, importance of degrees, as we had promised in the last video which we had shot together months back, I guess. So we were overwhelmed with the response. Everybody appreciated the video so much, and as promised, so now the stage is all yours. Welcome to Exotic Astrology.
Jai Shri Ram, Bhavajit ji. And thanks for inviting me on your forum again. Okay, let's start today's topic.
Yes.
Okay. Today we are going to discuss about role of degree in a chart. See, it's a general view. Students came to us and asked, "Sir, I have a Jupiter in my fifth house. What could be the possible result or outcome of it?" Similarly, if someone is asking, "I have Venus in my ascendant, what could be the result?" For an experienced astrologer, it is a difficult task to say a single line based on this single statement. Because we know that there are 8 other planets along with ascendant, which can, totally change the result.
Correct.
You know, without checking the whole chart, it is impossible to predict. And I'm giving you one example of it. See, we have two chart here, case A or case B. In both the chart, native have Venus in the Lagna. Okay. And according to different classical book, if someone is having Venus in the Lagna, it will it provide native interest in fine arts, beauty, things related to Venus. Right, Bhavaji ji?
Yes.
Okay. In the first chart, Venus posited in the Lagna along with Lagna Lord, Sun.
Yes.
And the Karaka of Lagna, which is Sun, is associated with Venus.
Yes. In
the first chart, we can say that the native must have a good physical appearance, charm, and at the same time, he must have interest in fine arts.
Okay, correct. Okay.
But in the second chart, no doubt Venus posited in the Lagna, but it is not connected with Sun, right?
Okay.
In both the chart, Venus aspecting the seventh house.
Oh.
Right? In second chart, Venus also aspect the seventh lord along with seventh house.
Okay.
So now the thing is, we need to pass on Venus state to the seventh house or to the life partner. In this case, we cannot say that the Venus traits would appear on the native. I'm getting my point, because we do not have connection of Venus with Lagna Lord in the second chart.
Okay.
So we have different factors for checking strength in astrology. The first one is Bhav Bala. If a planet is posited in Kendra, Trikona, we consider them as strong planet. And when they are in Trikabhava, 6, 8, 12, it is not considered good. Right? Similarly, Rashi Bala, when you are posited in exaltation sign, own sign, or in a friendly sign, we consider them as a strong planet. Neech Avastha, debilitation, or in an inimical sign, we consider them they are weak. So there are two concepts, Bhava Bala, Rashi Bala. Then we have aspects and conjunctions, right? If a planet is associated with the natural benefic planet or the lord of benefic houses, they become strong. Conjunction and aspect are the other factor. Then combustion and retrogression. We are not going into it deep. Then Kaltari, Pap Kaltari Yoga, Shubh Kaltari Yoga. Right, when a planet have in the adjoining houses, if we have two benefic planet, in that case we say that planet in Shubh Kaltari, and it will provide strength to the planet. And in the same way, Pap Kaltari, when you have two malefic planet in the adjoining houses, then it's a Pap Kaltari, not good.
Correct.
Then degree, one of the most important part of the chart, Vinshopaka Bala. Vinshopaka Bala is a score given to a planet when they attain strength in divisional chart.
Yes.
Okay. then Ashtak Varga point, and then finally overall Shadbalam. Out of all these factors, in this video, we are going to discuss about degrees. And the rest we will discuss in later videos, if you permit me, Bhavajit ji.
You are always permitted.
Okay, let's move it. So, now.
Wow, beautiful.
So again, the same chart here. In the first chart, Sun, Lagna degree is 20 and Venus degree is 7. So we have around 13 degree gap between Ascendant and Venus, right?
Okay. Yes, 13 degrees, correct.
And there's a 14 degree gap between Venus and Sun.
Correct.
Okay. In the other chart, Venus is quite close to the Ascendant degrees.
Okay. Yes. So, almost the same degree.
Almost of the same degree. So in these cases, in the second case, we can say that the traits related to Venus will quite impactful.
Okay.
Even on the seventh house, because if you have 18 degree in the Lagna, seventh house midcusp will be at the same degree, which is 18 degree 31 minute. So it represents that the impact of Venus would be quite great in the second chart.
Okay, I see.
Okay, the other thing is in the first chart, Sun is associated with Mercury and Venus, or we can say on one side of the Lagna Lord we have Mercury, and on the other side of Sun we have Venus. This is called Shubha Madhya Yoga.
Oh.
Okay, when you have two natural benefic planet, one is ahead of you and one is behind you, in that case we say the planet becomes Shubha Madhya Yoga. So such native will have a good life, definitely associated with benefic influence.
Okay.
And who is the second Lord Bhavaji ji in the first case?
Mercury
is moving towards Lagna, right?
Okay.
Because it's retro.
Okay, capital is written.
Okay. So Mercury is moving towards Lagna and Lagna Lord.
Yes.
So it's a good combination for having wealth.
Oh, the wealth is coming to you. It's something like
coming
that.
Coming towards you. Right. You don't need to do much effort. It's not, you are not following the money. Money is coming towards you automatically.
Oh.
So without doing too much of effort, things are coming to you.
Oh, interesting.
Right. So now, how conjunction can be changed due to degrees, how its result may vary. Okay, we discuss about it when the Lagna Lord is associated with two benefic planet, right? And now in this chart, the Lagna Lord and the seventh Lord both are sitting together. In the 10th house, right?
Yes, correct. Mars, okay. Venus.
Mars, Venus. But we have unwanted guest here. Rahu and Saturn is also posited there.
Correct.
And if we say that Rahu is in the middle of Venus and Mars, or between the Lagna Lord and Seventh Lord, there is a planet called Rahu. Right?
Okay.
So, in such condition, their married life would not be great. Even though they are sitting together.
Okay.
And because Rahu is in the middle, Rahu represents deception, right? Maya. Okay. So there are chances that either for earning money or for some other reason related to opposite sex, there must be some issues in their marriage.
And because it is Capricorn and Saturn is also there, so it can happen that they are bored with the person, that's why they are searching somebody else.
correct. Suppose if Rahu was not there, and if Rahu degree is less than 17 or 18, in such cases, I would not say that you will have a challenging married life, because in that case, there is no planet who is stopping you to meet.
Correct.
But in this case, because Rahu is in the middle of both the planet, Lagnesh and Saptamesh, Lagan Lord and Seventh Lord, it is not a good sign. Again, if we see from the Chandra Kundli or the moon chart, the situation remains same, right?
Correct.
Because again, they become Venus and Mars, and the things will remain same. So it is not a good sign for happy married life. And as you said, that because of the Capricorn sign and association with Saturn, boredom could be one of the reason.
Why I said was another thing is because you see, Saturn is behind Mars, all right? And Rahu is approaching Mars. So it's like Mars is going to Rahu. So Mars is hemmed between Saturn and Rahu. So Mars is the Lagna Lord. So it can happen that this is the person who is doing this, not the opposite sex, not the husband or the wife. So
hats off to you. Correct. Yes, you are right. Because as you said, that Mars is in Papa Madhya. From Mars, Rahu is ahead and Saturn is following him. And Rahu, being a retrograde planet, is moving towards Lagna Lord. And so in this case, deception would be from the side of this night, from the native side. Chances of having extramarital affair or due to some other reason, native must be the culprit. Who is creating issue in married life?
Because they say that the planet which is behind you, that will say why it begins and where it begins, and the planet which is next or ahead will tell you what happens ultimately. So Saturn is behind, so Saturn is saying, look, you're bored. And then what to do? Go to Rahu. And I also think
Right.
And I also think it can also happen in general, even if you ignore Venus as the seventh lord. It can also happen that he can have this, if it is a male native, provided he can have these kind of natures even within the workspace, because this is 10th house and Venus is also there. So something to do with ladies in the workspace, that can also happen.
Venus had the spice in this combination, I think. Without Venus, the things will remain same. As you said, that the things will remain same, that Mars, Rahu is coming towards Mars, so chances the wahan par bhi, that he will indulge in some other, how should I say? But because of Venus, we can say it amplify the things. And when we say that a Lagna Lord and Seventh Lord both are sitting together in a chart, it's a good sign. It's a good sign given in different classical book. But because of this Rahu in between Mars and Venus, the problem will be quite of great intensity.
And if suppose Mercury would be there behind Mars in place of Saturn, then could happen that because of some financial reason, the person is behaving like this. It can happen. But here also it can happen because Saturn is also the 11th Lord.
right. And one more thing, Bhavajiji, there's a degree difference of around 18 degree between Mars and Saturn. Right. So if suppose Saturn was at will be at 17 degree, in that case,
confirmed.
Yes. Okay, now moving ahead, let's discuss another aura of planets. See, according to my astronomy faculty, Mr. VP Jan, he always tell us that there is no boundary or wall in zodiac. So if a planet is at the end of the at the end of the sign, it may give you it may give you the result of the next sign.
Okay.
So it's about aura of planet. And there's a concept in Tajik Shastra. We need to check the degrees of the planets. For example, if Sun Diptamsha is 15 degree, it represents when a planet joins Sun, and if it is in the range of 15 degree, it will be affected by Sun.
Okay.
And if it if there's a gap of more than 15 degree, then the result of Sun conjunction would be quite less. So it's called Diptamsha theory, and the degree of Sun is 15, Moon 12 degree, Mars 8, Venus 7, Mercury 7, Jupiter 9, Saturn 9.
Okay.
So these are the degrees, which is called planetary aura. So suppose if two planets are sitting together, and if suppose Mars and Mercury both are sitting together, and there's a gap of more than 14 degree in the house, in that case, we should not consider close conjunction, and we should take care of it. What to say? Okay.
Wow.
Then the hidden aspect, it is also based on degrees, and you know, as all we know that each planet aspect the seventh house apart from Rahu Ketu, and the focal point of the aspect is 180 degree, or the focus is at the 180 degree. Okay. And from 180 degree, 15 degrees, if we add 15 in 180 degree and subtract 180 degree, in that case we will we get 165 to 195. So in this region Saturn have blur aspect from 165 to 195, and on 180 degree its aspect is quite crucial or impactful.
Okay.
Now in the same way, third aspect, the focal point of third aspect is 60 degree, exactly 60 degree.
Okay.
And from 45 to 75, blur aspect, but it still it's aspecting the house. Right. In the same way, fourth aspect, then we have the fifth aspect, which is focal point at 120 degree.
Okay.
Ninth aspect at 240 degree. From 225 to 255, and the 10th aspect from 270 degree focus point. Okay. Now, how to consider, how to interpret, or how to use these data, this data? In the given chart, Saturn being the seventh lord and at the same time eighth lord aspecting the Lagna, right?
Okay.
For Cancer ascendant, Saturn is not considered to be a good planet. It's a natural malefic planet, and owning the eighth house, obviously it is not good for Cancer ascendant. So it's aspecting the Lagna as well as the Lagna Lord.
Yes. Right.
So if we do not go into the degrees part and we say that the, you know, eighth Lord is aspecting the Lagna, and Lagna Lord, you may have struggle in your life. It will, it become difficult for you to achieve success in your life. And at the same time, Saturn represents detachment. So it also represents that there are chances of going into depression, right? These are all the things which are given in different books, that if your Saturn aspect the moon, these are the impact of this conjunction. Correct. Wish yoga. When Saturn moon conjoin, or when Saturn is having aspect on moon. But now let's talk about degree. Saturn is at 6 degree 20 minutes.
Correct.
And if we consider its 180 degree aspect, it will aspect the Cancer sign exactly 6 degree 20 minute.
Perfect.
Fine. Now, if we add 15 into it, 180 degree aspect is at 620. And if we add 15 into it, we got 20 degree, right? 620, 15.
Yeah, 22 or something like that.
21, 22.
Correct.
Now, the moon is at 25 degree 47 minutes. So in this case, Saturn is not aspecting moon with its seventh aspect. And we cannot say that because of the Saturn aspect, so and so things are happen in your life. Negative or challenging situation would not be there because of the Saturn. Because Saturn is not having influence over Lagna or the Lagna Lord.
Oh, yes.
Are you getting my point? See, the planet should be at the at around the same degree. For example, Mars is at 0049 and Saturn is at 6 degree 20 minute. So Saturn is aspecting Mars, because if we add 180 degree aspect would be at 6 degree 20 minute in the Lagna.
Correct.
If we subtract 15 from 620, we will get Gemini sign. So it is obviously it is aspecting the Lagna Mars.
Yes.
So in this case, we can say that Saturn is having influence over the 10th Lord.
Correct.
Not on Lagna and on Lagna Lord.
Okay, 10th Lord. Okay, I see.
So what I try to pass on that whenever you are going to see a chart, we should consider degrees. If we have a close conjunction with the planet, it will pass on its result. If there is a gap of more than 15 degrees, the impact would be quite less, or I would say zero.
Okay.
Let's take this case. In this case too, Saturn is in the 7th house aspecting Lagna.
Yes.
And associated with Lagna Lord.
Okay.
Right. For Taurus ascendant, Saturn is the Yoga Karaka planet. Being the Yoga Karaka planet, or being the 9th Lord aspecting Lagna and Lagna Lord, having influence over Lagna and Lagna Lord, it's a fantastic combination.
Yes.
Okay, and because of the degree close degree conjunction, there is no question about it that whether Saturn is aspecting Lagna or not. But now, Correct. Now let's talk about the 4th house. Saturn is having 10th aspect over the 4th house.
Correct.
It is also aspecting Moon there.
This time it is.
Yes, this time it is because of the Moon degrees at around 22 degree 38 minute, right? Okay, now your fourth Karak and fourth house both are influenced by Saturn. Now let's talk about fourth Lord. Who is fourth Lord here?
Surya.
And Sun is at 4 degree 57 minute.
Yeah, it is kind of away, I think, not.
Yes, you are right. Because Saturn is at 23, 37, we need to take 60 degree, the same degree in the third house. And if we subtract 15 out of it from 23-37, we will get 7 or 8 degrees.
7 or 8 degrees, yes.
And it is less than 7 or 8 degrees. So generally, when your fourth house, fourth Lord, and fourth Karaka all are influenced by the planet Saturn, it will not give you good result related to mental peace or domestic happiness.
Yes, correct.
Even though if it is a Yog Karaka, still being a malefic planet, natural malefic planet, it may give you property. It may give you property and other stuff. But
a lot of struggle in getting.
Yes, you're right. So, and at the same time, when you have aspect of Jupiter and Saturn, both these slow moving planet aspect on the same house. It show that you will achieve the karkas of that particular bhava or the house after struggle or after delay.
And here Jupiter also rules a difficult house.
Yes. And at the same time, Jupiter takes 1 year to complete to cover a sign, right? And Saturn takes 2.5. So they are the two slow moving planet. Aspect on a single house from Saturn and Jupiter represent a delay in getting result of that particular bhava.
Oh, this is something new I have heard.
Oh, really? Okay.
So yeah, I have seen Saturn, even if it is a yoga karak, like I have seen the chart of some Capricorn ascendants. There also Venus is a yoga karak and Shani is the lagnesh. But even when Saturn and Venus are conjunct, in one case, the person I know, he is around 31. He will turn 31 this year. And everything else is fine. He has moon in 7th and some other good things. But no, there's nothing about marriage. He has always been single. even when Venus is the fifth lord of love romance, and even another chart I know, Saturn Venus are aspecting for a Capricorn Lagna, still there are delays.
See, according to my sir, Saturn represent Saturn name in Sanskrit, it is called Shane, slow moving planet. And at the same time, the significations ruled by Saturn is detachment, virakti, vairagya, etc. So if it is associated with Venus, who is the planet of romance and affection, there would be some delay in getting it. And at the same time, this combination is not very good for having an affectionate life with your life partner.
Yes. And because it is Yukarak, it can have some other benefits like Lagnesh and fifth lord combined. That can give them a lot of intelligence, which is there in both of these people. I have seen that.
Correct.
That is very true. So here also the person will likely be very spiritual and likely be very much work focused because the 10th lord also aspects.
Right.
Fantastic this is.
So, okay, fine. It's over now. Let's talk about the, let's cover the point again. Whenever you see the chart, we need to see the conjunction of the planet. It's quite basic and it is required in a chart. We need to see the association of that particular planet before saying a single statement for that for the planet. Then in case of conjunction, we need to see the degrees, who is going ahead, who is moving, who is in back of you. As you said earlier, that the planet
Saturn
and Mars, giving you the example of Saturn and Rahu in the second case. And then the aspect. In aspect point of view, it is quite crucial to check the degrees. Without degree, it is not it is not very result giving. And in Shadbala, when we calculate the Drishtibal, in that method also, degrees are quite crucial.
Okay.
So this is the point which I want to make here. That without checking the degrees, it is not good for checking the chart.
Fantastic. I'm very sure the audience got rocked after seeing this. Like I got rocked. Yeah, I never thought. I mean, yes, I always knew that the degrees are important, but the way you explained in that chart and the way we saw that, who is causing that affair? Because many times people say, oh, I have Venus Rahu conjunct. Yes, my seventh lord is with Rahu.
Right.
Or something to do with Rahu is very prominent. So who will do the cheating? Will it be me or the other person?
Correct.
So then we don't have an answer to that in general. I mean, yes, you can always see if the Lagna lord is aspecting that from some other house, not from the sky, then that can happen. But if a scenario is like this, that the Lagna lord, seventh lord, and then planet like Rahu is there in between, then it becomes very easy to tell. And then if you have planets like Saturn on the background, then you can also say that what is the reason.
So we can
warn them about all these things. For example, if this chart would come to you, yes, and if a girl would send this chart, so then you could warn the girl that yes, see that this person is likely to get bored very soon. Something of that sort. Yeah, so...
Not bluntly, but yeah, we can give a hint to him or her that these are the possibilities. And as you said that, whenever there's a chart of deception or chances of extramarital affair, we need to check the character of the Lagna and the seventh house. And this is one of the method through which we can say which one is going to break the law or break the social norms. And at the same time, when you make this point, the aspect of Sun, Jupiter or Mars, combination with Jupiter Mars or Sun Mars on the Lagna, and having ascendant of Sagittarius of Jupiter, Sun, it represents that the chances of the native to involve in such relation are quite less.
Okay.
Whereas Mercury Venus ascendant, Gemini, Libra, and
they're waiting when the time is going to come.
Yes, you're right. They wait for the correct time, and they manage also. You know, they manage also. For them, it's easy to, you know, handle such cases. I have seen so many people who are involved in such things, and they are managing it quite well.
Oh. Anyway. Yeah, because Leo and Zag and Pisces, they represent more that dharma aspect is there.
Ethical point.
Karakas of the ninth house, Jupiter and Sun. So they are like, no, we have done it once. We are married. We are like Lord Ram. Ek patni vrat. We will not do it again.
Correct. And you know, Sun represent social norms. So Leo ascendant generally do not involve in such relation because they have fear of social image, social humiliation, I would say. That there are chances of humiliation which they cannot accept.
They love their status very much.
They love their status. And Seji was, yes, you are right, dharma bhava, and they sincerely involve in a relationship until or unless we have a very dramatic combination of planet Venus, Rahu, Mars, and the Lagna. Otherwise, generally they are quite reliable, honest people. So this is how it is.
I've seen that. Fantastic. So, which is the next topic you are going to speak on? Is it Panchang or is it something else?
Yeah.
We are discussing on Panchang.
Yep. Panchang is very important topic, and as per one of my guru, Shri Suresh Chandra Mishra. He always mentioned that, whenever you print a chart or whenever you see a manual chart created by a pandit, the first page represent your panch anga, tithi, yog, var, nakshatra, karna. And then we have the birth chart. And in today's era, we straight away jump into the chart part, birth chart, what is your lagna, where is your moon is posited, where is your other planet are posited. As per my sir, we should check the Panchang part first, and then we should come to the birth chart part. Okay. So, and no doubt, Panchang and Tithi particularly plays a very important role in the life of the native. Okay. I'm just giving you one hint. Panchami, the fifth lunar day, Dashmi, tenth day, and the Purnima are called Siddha. These three Tithi are called Siddha Tithi. So, if a person born on these five tithi, it becomes easy for them to complete the objectives. They can stick to the task. They can easily complete the task. And in the same way, 3rd, 8th and 13th, Tritya, Ashtami and Triyodashi, it represents Jaya Tithi.
Oh.
So, it represents, struggle. And victory over it.
Oh, okay.
So it's a very interesting topic, and we can discuss about Muhurat also. If we talk about Panchang part, Muhurat is quite connected with it, and it's quite logical. I read a few Muhurat books in which it is given. This is called Sarvat Siddhi Yoga, Amrit Yoga, Siddhi Yoga, etc. And the concept or the logic behind those yoga are quite fantastic and simple. I don't know why people are not following it, but we should focus on it, because through these aspects or through this tithi and var combination, we can predict the behavior of the native.
Okay, so before you go, one thing I wanted to ask you. So in this regard only of Panchang, I mean, maybe we can talk on this detail later, but I just wanted to know, like some people say to me that, okay, so they say that marriages should be done either on Thursdays or on Fridays, preferably. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's one thing. And then they also say that it should be done on Sthira Nakshatras.
Right. Yes. Dhruva Nakshatra. So
they try to mix it. Either it's Rohini or Uttar Falguni or Uttar Ashada or something like that.
Right.
So now then, of course, generally it happens that around Friday or Thursday, either of these Nakshatras come sometimes. But sometimes, suppose it doesn't come, or you take an imaginary scenario that for the next 1 year, there is no Sthira Nakshatra coming, or any nakshatra where you can perform marriages. Suppose it is not coming on Friday or Thursday. So then what do? You give weightage more to the nakshatra or to the day, bara?
Okay. Quite a good question. See, first of all, it's a generic statement that marriage should be done on Thursday or Friday. Because it's owned by Jupiter and, Venus.
Correct.
Thursday and Friday. But we need to check. Suppose if your ninth lord is Saturn, your ninth lord is Saturn, there's no harm in doing marriage on Saturday. Siddha Pusha, I would say, having a Siddhi, reside in Una. He always, suggests people that you should start a new initiative on Saturday.
Oh.
If you want a long run, if you want to stabilize a thing, Saturn, he prefers Saturday over other day. So, first of all, we should focus on the birth chart of the native. Even in case of chart matching, Bhavaji ji, marriage proposal, Muhurata date, generally what pundits do or what we do, we open the Panchang. There are two pages on which it is given for Mesh, Kanya, for Tula, Var. These are the dates on which you can do marriage.
Okay.
It's only based on the moon sign of the native.
Okay.
And it's quite risky, I would say, that before seeing the proper chart, without analyzing the proper chart, you are suggesting a date only on the base of moon.
Okay.
So, as you said, that practically, no doubt, there is no day. I would say there is not a single day on which there is no blemish effect.
Okay.
On each and every day, we have five factors. Most probably three would be beneficial, two would be not so good. So we cannot.
Or the hora will be of Saturn when the pandit says you have to put them this.
So generally, we should we prefer Muhurata. There are 30 Muhurata in a day, if I'm not wrong.
Abhijit included one of.
Including Abhijit, right. And they are fixed. They don't change. They depend on sunrise time. So we can use those Muhurta if we do not have any option.
Okay.
Do not have any option.
Okay.
Otherwise it is good. And it is not, I would say, rare to have a nakshatra and a day combination.
Okay.
Now I'm giving you one more example.
Mm-hmm.
First, sixth and 11th tithi are called Nanda tithi.
Okay.
Nanda means Anand, right? For having pleasure. So having a physical intimacy or for going with your family for pleasure, it's a good day, Nanda tithi. First, sixth and 11th. Now you tell me which planet you can consider related to these Ananda Tithi out of all nine planets?
Moon and Venus.
Venus, right. So yes. If we have Friday on Nanda Tithi, it is called Siddhi Yoga, Sarvat Siddhi Yoga. It's as simple as this.
Oh, okay. So if these tithis are falling on a Friday.
Yeah. So it's quite simple and quite logical. Similarly, on Jaya Tithi, what day you would you prefer? It is for victory.
Mars or something like that.
Ah, yeah, you're great. Tuesday.
So if that falls on Tuesday, it is like you will always be victor. Something like that.
Yes, it's a good combination, auspicious Muhurta for doing things. For doing, for filing a case against your enemy. Or for planning something like that, or for having a cricket match.
Okay, and there can be combinations also. Suppose somebody is born on a Friday, and then maybe somebody is born in a Monday. Because and those three you said, na, it is good for
first, sixth, and 11th. Right.
Yes. So those things can.
He's here for enjoying the life. If you born on 1st, 6th and 11th day of the lunar month or lunar cycle and it falls on Friday, it represents that you are here in this world for enjoying or for pleasure, for bhog.
Oh.
So okay. This is how we need to check. And it is, I would say it's quite fantastic to use Panchang before going to the birth chart. And
because that will tell us what the person is, and then we see what Lagnis is doing in the 10th, not that he's going to. If he doesn't want to work only, then even if the Lagna Lord or Sun is there in the 10th, what will he do in life? Yes, I mean, he may do big things, but that will not be his goal because we are seeing the chart in a wrong direction.
Correct.
The Panchang will tell us what to look in which direction actually, and then the chart will tell us what to look in that direction.
Correct. We were quite mesmerized or surprised when my teacher Sureshan Mishra tell us about the Panchang part, how Tithi can be used, how Nakshatra, how Yoga crucial, or Karna's impact of Karna in one's life. So it's quite impactful and result giving.
So I think next time the first session we could take it on Vara, maybe whatever is comfortable for you.
Right. It's up to you. We can select any of the thing, Var or combination of Var with Tithi, or combination with Nakshatra on the other things. Var on I forgot the name. Nakshatra and Tithi. Sorry, Nakshatra and
yes.
Tithi. Guru Pushya Yoga. Right.
Oh, Thursday Pushya Nakshatra.
Right.
Oh, so, okay. Fantastic. I am waiting when that session time will come now, because Vara is something, and Nakshatras, of course, because they will tell us where to look, and then you go there and see what's happening.
Right.
Because so many times I have seen charts, they're the same Nakshatras and same things, but behavior is completely different. I know so many people with Mula Nakshatra especially. It is a so-called very spiritual Nakshatra, so-called. Mm. But I've seen people, that there are some people who are like probably the least interested. Maybe they are born in that. Maybe they are born on a Monday or a Friday with those tithis.
Correct.
So then they will go deep into pleasure. And that trait is there in them. Because whenever I call these people, now they will always keep asking, oh, so how's your life in Germany? You must be having the time of your life. And then I'm wondering, your moon is in Mula, man. I can't believe it.
See, we generally say that Surya, Chandrama and the Lagna Lord, these three are the vital point of our chart, right? And yes. The Panchang part totally depends on sun and moon's longitude. If you want to calculate the tithi, you have to subtract sun's longitude from the moon and divide it by 12. It's a calculative part, but still we need to these all panchang part are dependent on sun and moon. So yes, you're right. It can give us idea about the objective of the native in this life.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. I think the later part was more interesting. So, all right. Thank you very much once again. And the next time we see each other, it will be on Panchang and we can decide on whatever it is. All right. Thank you very much then. Once again, thank you very much.
Jai Shri Ram.
Jai Shri Ram.